Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm starting off today doing something that I don't normally do, and I'm going to quote Speaker of the House Nancy Pelosi. In March, the Speaker told the Washington Post, and I'm going to quote this, "Impeachment is so divisive to the country that unless there's something so compelling and overwhelming and bipartisan, I don't think we should go down that path because it divides the country." Well, on that, the Speaker and I both agree. And you know who else agrees? The Founding Fathers. The Founding Fathers recognized that crimes warranting impeachment must be so severe, regardless of political party, that there is an agreement that the actions are impeachable. But let's go back to Speaker Pelosi's words just one more time. The Speaker says the case for impeachment must be also compelling. Well, after last month's shift show, this is what we learned. There is no evidence that the President directed anyone to tell the Ukrainians that aid was conditioned on investigation. Aside from the mere presumptions by Ambassador Sondland, there is no evidence that Trump was conditioning aid on investigation. And if you doubt me, just go back to the actual transcript, because never in that call was the 2020 election mentioned, and never in that call was military aid mentioned. In fact, President Trump told Senator Johnson on 31 August that aid was not conditioned on investigation. Rather, President Trump was rightfully skeptical about the Ukrainians. Their country has a history of corruption, and he merely wanted the Europeans to contribute more to a problem in their own backyard. But I think we can all agree that it's appropriate for the President, as a steward of taxpayer dollars, to ensure that our money isn't wasted. I said I wasn't going to go back to Speaker Pelosi, but I do want to go back because I forgot. She also said that impeachment should be only pursued when it's, quote unquote, overwhelming. So it's probably not good for the Democrats that none of the witnesses who testified before the Intel Committee were able to provide firsthand evidence of a quid pro quo. But I forgot we're calling it bribery now after the focus group last week, and there's no evidence of bribery either. Instead, the two people who did have firsthand knowledge, the President and President Zelensky, both say there was no pressure on the Ukrainians. And again, the transcript of July 25th backs this up. And to go back to Nancy Pelosi one more time, she said that the movement for impeachment should be, quote unquote, bipartisan, which is actually the same sentiment echoed by our chairman, Jerry Nadler, who in 1998 said, and I quote, "There must never be a narrowly voted impeachment supported by one of the major political parties and opposed by another." Well, when the House voted on the Democrats' impeachment inquiry, it was just that. It was the only bipartisan vote was the one imposing the inquiry. The partisan vote was the one to move forward with the inquiry. So we're 0 for 3. Let's face it, this is a sham impeachment against President Trump. It's not compelling, it's not overwhelming, and it's not bipartisan. So even by the Speaker's own criteria, this has failed. Rather, what this is nothing more than a partisan witch hunt, which denies the fundamental fairness of our American justice system and denies due process to the President of the United States. The Democrats' case is based on nothing more than thoughts, feelings, and conjectures, and the thoughts and feelings of a few unelected career bureaucrats. And the American people are absolutely fed up. Instead of wasting our time on this, we should be doing things like passing USMCA, lowering the cost of prescription drugs, and working on our failing infrastructure in this country. With that said, Mr. Turley, I've watched as your words have been twisted and mangled all day long. Is there anything you would like to clarify?
Only this. I think that one of the disagreements that we have, and I have with my esteemed colleagues, is what makes a legitimate impeachment. Not what technically satisfies an impeachment. There's very few technical requirements of an impeachment. The question is, what is expected of you? And my objection is that there is a constant preference for inference over information, for presumptions over proof. That's because this record hasn't been developed. And if you're going to remove a president, if you believe in democracy, if you're going to remove a sitting president, then you have an obligation not to rely on inference when there's still information you can gather. And that's what I'm saying. It's not that you can't do this. You just can't do it this way.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Did you gentleman yields back.